help her with, help the community with, either by teaching or being a part of it, coming. And welcome to Channel 58, Victor Network, Carol.
Thank you.
How in the world did you get involved with community education and start that off by telling us exactly what community education is?
Okay. Well, everybody knows what community is.
That's right.
Everybody knows that word.
We all do.
Right. Everybody knows what education is.
Yes.
But when you put community and education together, something magic happens, something special happens. When community education happens, and it can happen through a school or a church or any other agency, it just happens that ours happens through the Huntsville City Schools. That's who employs me. It is a way for people and community itself, individuals and the community itself, to assess their needs, their problems, their wants, their desires, and to prioritize and decide which is a problem and which is a want and which is a real need, and then to work together to meet all those needs.
Situations, mm-hmm. challenges, and opportunities, mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. what might happen out in NASA, Marshall, or any other company that would cut back on its employment. I never will forget one time my husband, the company he worked with, went from 90 employees back to 60. So one of the things he did during that period of time was take a few courses so he could learn computers and get up on things that were happening now. I know you started teaching a long time ago.
Yes.
In fact, you had one little really interesting time that you taught in Germany.
Yes.
When you and
yes.
your husband were over there and he was in the service.
That's right. I'm a K-12 teacher. In fact, I was a senior high school teacher. I taught English.
Never going to let her read my book. English teacher. So was my mother, so I should.
That's right. So I do come through the K-12 program, and I did teach in a very unusual situation. I taught in a maximum security prison in Germany, and this was a prison for all men. I was one of three women among 500 men. Very young, thank goodness I was young, or I wouldn't have done that.
You wouldn't do it today.
That's right, and it was a very rewarding job in that I did see people who had no hope get a glimmer of hope. And I'm not saying we reached every man that we worked with, but if we reached one or two or even three, it was worth every ounce of effort that we put into it. And it was a blessing to do that, to work in a prison. Really, maximum security. I'm talking about rapists, murderers, the real, when you think of the worst felons in the world, those were what we had. And it was exciting. So maybe if they had had community education in their childhood, they wouldn't have ended up where they were.
Well, what did Lyndon Johnson say, among other things, was that there were 100,000 young men?
Well, actually, there were. They were called Johnson's 100,000, and they were men who had not had high school educations, and they came into the service. They were pulled into the service, and of course, this was back during Vietnam, and men were greatly needed at that time. And I had the privilege of working with some of those. They were the ones in my class in the prison
who
didn't have a high
school
education.
And not only that we can get back into the workforce through some training, through community education, and all the other things that we're going to find out a little bit about your shirt, but one of the things that's happening is this open university or school without walls. And back in Johnson's day, he even said, tomorrow's school will be a school without walls, a school built by doors which open to the entire community. Tomorrow's school will reach out to places that enrich the human spirit. Tomorrow's school will be the center of community life for grown-ups as well as children, a shopping center for human services.
That's
Isn't that
right.
exciting?
A shopping center for human
and
services.
You know what? You can even get college credit for writing a book. I know there are people who would like to write a book and have always felt like, oh, I wish I had some college. And they will actually give you college credit in some of these open universities.
In some of the universities.
Now, tell me some things that you have. And also, I understand that there is this actually saves taxpayers' money.
Right,
how
right.
in the world does it do that?
Well, let me just back up. I'm glad you used the school without walls quote, because that was one that my boss, Ike Rooks, and I'm proud. Happy Bosses Day, boss. I'm glad you used that quote because that's one of his favorites and one that he used in our annual report this year. And the school without walls is one of the things that we try to be. And because we bring ourselves to the school system, it becomes a school without walls, and it does in many ways save taxpayers money. And I will tell you some of those ways. First of all, we have this beautiful, wonderful, and I wish everybody would come and see our beautiful school at Challenger Middle School in South Huntsville. That's where I work, and I'm really proud of it. That building cost $11 million. And because of our very wise administration in this school system, we are
able
not...
Does she get a raise after all that?
I need one, don't I? Not really. I do it for fun, I think. Because we have this wise administration to put community education there, we are now using that building not 6 hours a day for this limited clientele, 6 years old to 18 years old, but we're using it all day long. We can use it 12 or 18 hours a day if we need to. We can use it on weekends if we need to. We can open it up to
this list of school classes that we were going through. You better use it 18
right.
20 and hours a day, 8 days a week.
That's right. And we can use it for people who are not just the school-age people. We can use it from toddlers to the 80-year-old.
Yeah, we always think of community education as someone, I need to go back and brush up on my typing skills mm-hmm. so I can get a job.
That's right.
But that's just one tiny little phase of it.
Tiny. And did you realize that 73% of the adults in Alabama do not have children in school? Why should they support the schools? It's not for them, or is it? Whose schools are they? Do they belong to the teacher? No, not really. Do they belong to the principal? Well, certainly not. Do they belong to the school children? Well, in many ways it seems they do. Well, do they belong to the custodian? Well, not really. He just cleans the building and seems to be the most popular fellow at the school. If you ever want to know what was going on in school, go ask the custodian. They will know. But it belongs to the taxpayers. And so because we have this... In fact, it's the most valuable things that the taxpayers really own, and that is that's why we want to use it. We want to open it up for birth through death. We want to open it up winter and summer. We want to open it up day and night and get the fullest use we can. And you ask how it saved the taxpayer money. Along with opening up the building, this expensive building, for fuller use, we also try to bring in volunteers. We try to break down those barriers between the school and other agencies, between the school and community members, and say, now, community, let's talk. What do we really want? Where do we want to go? How do we want to grow? What are our needs? And therefore, every community school program is different. Mine is different from the one across the town at Davis Hills and the other one across town at Westlawn, because I'm meeting South Huntsville's needs. And I'm talking to South Huntsville. I'm writing notes to teachers and saying, teachers, what do we need? What can we do to make our community a better place? What can we do to make individuals in this community a better place? I'm calling in my students in the middle school even and saying, now talk to me. I want to have an advisory group of you. Tell me what needs can we meet that you can think of. It is your school too. You own this. It is part, it's something that you own. And parents, the PTA boards of all my schools are working with me to help assess needs. And of course, that's one of the things that community education does, is to assess the needs of the community. And that doesn't mean necessarily that we have a big survey sheet and we mail that out to the community and say, what do you want to do at your school? They wouldn't answer it. They would throw it in the trash. So we have to work a little bit harder to find out what the needs are. We have to talk to people. When they come to a class, we have to go and say, well, how did you like that? Did it meet your needs?
A
person from the Arsenal called me the other day and said, I'm so concerned. We are all worried about losing our jobs because we know that they're going to have a big reduction in forces. And is there anything we can do? And I said, I know just the trick. One of the teachers called in the other day. She wants to teach speed writing. And speed writing is something you can learn in 6 sessions well enough to be proficient and pass the government test. So we offer speed writing at a very low price, and maybe some of the secretaries or workers on the Arsenal will come and take that and feel a little more secure in their job.
I noticed they also have basic camera techniques. So
yes.
There's some, video is growing by leaps and Well, it's growing a lot anyway, leaps and bounds. I went in December or January sometime with the Society of Professional Videographers, and somebody has to know how to do those things, and there's not enough.
Right.
UAH is really not doing that particular thing, and not a lot of high schools don't do that.
And even if they were, they're way across town, and this is in our community. We don't have to go anywhere. Many people can walk right over to the school. There's a senior citizen, a dear one, and I won't say her name, and she'll probably know who she is. And I bet she has signed up for 8 different courses this time. She comes to play bridge, and she comes to aerobics, and she comes to, she came to a flower arranging course. And I'm so happy that this dear, dear person comes and is a part of life and a part of community and enjoys herself.
I see a lot of these courses only cost $5. I mean, hey, you can't even go out to eat for that.
Some of the courses don't cost anything. Last year in Huntsville City, there were almost 5,000 people who took fee courses, courses that you have to pay a small fee for. And there were almost 3,000 people who took courses that were not feed at all. So about 8,000 more people use the schools than would have used it if they hadn't been there.
And they were also, this is part of it which I didn't realize, when we had the tornado.
Yes, our community education extended day, we are so proud of it. Right now I have 500 students in my South schools. I have Whitesburg and Mountain Gap and Weatherly and Farley and Chaffee. Chaffee is a new school this year for extended day, and Challenger, of course. And we have from 2:30 in the afternoon until 5:45 in the evening. Teachers meet those children when they get out of school with a snack and fun things to do. They play outside and play in the gym and do arts and crafts, and they don't have to be bussed away. It's a very safe and happy, it's their own environment. But it's not school. It's not like the school day. This is different,
but
even
that,
though it's called extended day.
Of course, they were kept safe during
yes,
the
they were. Those were
the
extended day teachers, and we were that Jones Valley that took those children where to go.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's a good example of how they are keeping our children safe.
Mm-hmm. Parents as tutors, minimizing the homework hassle, the doable dozen. Why are these written, and how would one use them?
Okay, well, one of the things that we like to think about when we open up the school's walls is how we can keep duplication of services out of the way. So if we see something that somebody else is doing, they can come in with us, and one of those things is inviting parents or businesses even, or grandparents, anybody who wants to come and have a part in what we're doing. You know, you hear about adopt-a-school programs all the time, and so-and-so business gave X amount of dollars to the school, but there's so many more things that they can give that are, well, I mean, money is always important in schools, but people are, how much more important?
They change computers and no longer use those boxes of computer paper.
That's
you'll
right.
take them.
We'll take their computer paper, or we'll take any service
they
that they want
like
to donate. If they
services?
Want to help us prepare some materials, if they want to let some of their employees be free to come and tutor or to present.
How do they let you
know? Well, sometime during this program, I hope that you will give me a chance to share my office phone number and
Go right ahead.
This is a good time. Okay. I am at Challenger Community School, and we are located in the Challenger Middle School. And our phone number at the office is 532-3063. I'll repeat it again. It's 532-3063. And as you can see, I'm not at the school today. My answering machine is probably on, and if it's not on, we have a part-time secretary. We are not there. If we're not there, our answering machine will answer, and if the secretary's there, she'll answer. But we always return our calls. So please, if you get the machine, don't hesitate to leave a message and say who you are and how we can help you, or how you can help us, because we are there to do both.
So in addition to things like my son had gone back and gotten his GED
mm-hmm.
and through getting his high school education, because he had needed to do that. We had moved from one state to another at that time, and so he just lacked a few courses. So he's a plant manager.
Wonderful.
It's just an incredible story of how that training like what we have in community education has helped. Who are some of the people that you could think of?
Oh, I could just tell you so many stories about this. I'll tell you, well, here's the GED, of course, is one, because we always hear people who get that GED and it just is a springboard for the rest of their lives. And sometimes the courses that you wouldn't even think would be, quote, educational, turn out to be a career for somebody. I'll tell you two different people that happened to. One lady took the cake decorating course, and she began to make things for her friends and her neighbors, and pretty soon it began to grow, and pretty soon she had a little business. And there, out of one community ed course, another lady that I know here in Huntsville, and it's funny because I knew her in Birmingham, and then she moved here after we moved here, made beautiful hair bows, and you have a wonderful one in your hair
this
today.
$15.
Whoa, aren't they expensive?
But I bought it so I can learn how to do that.
Right.
I need to go to her class. I didn't
She's
know
She's going
was
to teach this
oh,
coming
right.
time. In fact, she'll be teaching probably when this airs. And I knew her, and she had taken a couple of community education courses, and she met a friend when they moved to Atlanta. And the friend said, well, let's take all these to the Mart and just see what happens. Well, they took them to the Mart and had so many orders coming in that almost instantly, this business, and the business is called Rainbows. Mm-hmm. They have a business where they make bows and sweatshirts. And
well,
so
you have on a sweatshirt.
Yes,
tell
one
us
of
about
our,
that one.
This is a Christmas sweatshirt that one of our teachers, Teresa Salgi, is going to do, and she may do this one, or she and another one too. We have so many fun Christmas crafts this time.
Okay, here comes.
Oh no,
I'm it ready. You think I just gained weight, didn't you? But wait till you see what all I have underneath that she brought for me, and this is.
Ta-da! Right.
Well, let me show you this. And this one is fun.
Let me help you.
Okay. This is just one of the things that they're teaching different. Uh-oh. I just realized
got
there's
microphone.
My microphone. So I'm going
to have
to pin it back over here, too. But this is a fun microphone, but I don't know if it'll pick up what I want to do. This is Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Now, I don't know, Mr. Microphone, if you can hear this or not, but we're going to see.
His nose lights up and he sings. But yeah, that's another, this is another class that's going to be offered. There, you know, there are so many funny and fun courses. This is going to be taught by Melissa Roth. Teresa Salgi is the one that's going to teach this one. But they are lots of fun.
And they do them for different seasons.
Right.
And, some
and this one
just
is something
fun.
You can do in one night. This is not something you have to go every Tuesday. A lot of classes are one night and two night courses that you could just take for the fun of it.
And someone at Toastmasters asked me to do one. And I said, well, I'll do it. And
that's
it's
right.
about how to feel comfortable public speaking. I have a real thing about that because when I was 14 years old, I ran for state song leader in the 4-H club, and I was up on this little platform, like stage, and I forgot my name, what the name of the song was, where I was, why I was there, and I ran off that stage crying, and I said, I can't do it. And so my main leader in 4-H club said, oh, yes, you can. You get right back up there. And so I got through that horrible experience, but I bowed. Father, in the name of Jesus, if you will let me feel comfortable and not shake so much standing in front of a group, I will do that. And so I've learned not only to do it, but I love it now. It's just like somebody in school that you finally get them to play in a play, and you find out they're the biggest hams that you have. You couldn't get them to be in the play, and then they decided to.
I hope everybody takes your course because you are so.
It is going to be fun. We're going to have a wild and crazy time. And we're going to have
even
everybody.
You feel comfortable, and this is not my normal habitat, see, so you are really good at it.
Hey, I knew that you were a teacher before, and I got to hear that one little story about when you were teaching and you first found out they were going to have community education.
Oh, this is, I shouldn't even tell this, but since you've asked, I'll have to. I was a K-12 teacher. I was a classroom teacher, and sometimes the biggest job we have is to convince the classroom teachers, the K-12 teachers and the office staff, that we're important too and we're a part of them and that we can help them. Now, I don't have have that problem very much at Challenger because we have a great group of people to work with. But teachers sometimes have a little bit of possessiveness.
When you first heard
and I'm
about
talking
it.
About me. When I heard about community education, I had gotten a fellowship, and I thought, sure, I'll take your money to go to school. I love to go to school. And then I found out I had to learn to be a community education coordinator. And I said, what is community education? And they said, oh, well, that's just a wonderful process that people come through and they own their schools and they come in the evenings. And I said, in the evenings? Not in my school. When I leave my classroom, I wipe my board down very carefully. And I put my chalk where I want it so that we walk in at 8 o'clock in the morning and everything is perfect because I want my children to be perfect. Well, it took Dr. Boyd Rogan at University of Alabama in Birmingham about 6 months to cure me of that and to convince me. And once he did, it is addictive. It is the most wonderful thing. And I cannot imagine ever not having community schools after once experiencing the value of opening up the schools to the community and the community to the school, and seeing the vandalism decrease, seeing the schools opened night and day, seeing volunteers come in, seeing people enrich themselves and therefore enrich the community, and sometimes not even enrich themselves, enrich the community because they are there. When people can see their needs, see their problems, work on a plan to meet them, and then try to meet the plan in a really reasonable and practical way, we are just, you know, it's so impressive that sometimes I stand back and say, oh, I'm so glad to be a part of this.
Well, you were telling that you liked everything, you're a board erased and your chalk in a certain place.
Mm.
Well, you know, that's a certain personality. We're talking about the personality traits that a lot of people, when they're born and they grow up and they like everything very orderly, and there's other people that are in the room, they're like Tony. So, I mean, he knows where the first nickel, I guess, he ever had, and his socks are orderly in the drawer, and he married this tossed salad lifestyle person. But, you know, you can take courses that will teach you about the different kinds of, whether you have an otter personality that's just enjoys life, you know, and then, or you're a person who's more like a golden retriever, and or you know, we can talk about dominant influencer and competent, the different personalities that we have, the type A personality. Well, you can learn those at a class
that you're going to. That's right. In fact, that's a class that you could probably teach.
That'd be a fun class to do. But more than that, it helps you to understand other people you're working with.
Right.
If you have a people problem, it could be that you could learn something.
That's right.
I'll never forget when Emily went back to school that I was almost sad because as I looked over her curriculum, I thought, oh, I want to do that. And I'd already taken the course and passed it, but it was so much fun to go to school. I want to go back to school there. But now we can.
That's right. When you were saying that, it reminded me that I would love to find a teacher who could teach a course called How Not to Be Shy. A course for teenage girls, how to grow up gracefully. We have a lovely teacher, Carol Johnson is her name, and she teaches a course in manners for young girls. And these are 5th, 6th, 7th grade. It's a darling course.
Oh, you were looking for somebody to teach tatting, too.
Right.
Oh, let's go through these real quickly. And Chisholm Bop. I never heard of that. Now, what is it?
Well, Chisholm Bop is an oriental math game, almost. It's a way of figuring math on your fingers. I can't do it.
I want to take that course.
I do, too. I know it's taught in Birmingham, and I have a sister-in-law who teaches it in Georgia, and you see children sit down and add 5,472 and 3,677 and 7,888 and come up with the right answer in an instant, and they're all the time doing their little fingers like this. I don't know how they do it, but if there's a Chisholm Bop teacher anywhere listening to us, please call me and help us teach that
retirement
course.
Retirement planning and saving for college, archery, wood burning, art of verbal self-defense, love that one, cooking, breads, candies, Chinese, Mexican, party foods with the holidays coming up, stained glass, rag baskets, rag rugs, preparing for ACT, how to balance your checkbook. Why in the world don't they teach that in school?
You know,
I'm telling you, I don't understand. Now they are. They're going to be teaching it in community education. But you know, anybody can take. You don't have to be graduated to take that. Because I'm taking a DOS, which is a PC course in Gunnersville at one of the schools over there. Didn't know you taught it right here in Huntsville. But anyway, and there's 11-year-olds in there, and there's I won't say. Over the evil people in there, too. Financial consensus and special need for the elderly. I can't even say it. I don't know. I'm going to soon have to do it.
Yes, sometimes our seniors are forgotten people, and the schools are there for them just as much as they are for any other person in the community. And that's a wonderful resource that they can use. But more than that, they can be such resources. I wish that I could find somebody to teach every one of those almost lost arts. When I was a little girl and when you were a little girl, I bet that you went home and your mother and your Aunt Sally and your grandmother sat down and taught you. You made a doll quilt.
Mm-hmm.
You'd crocheted.
Mm-hmm.
You did a cross-stitch sampler. Remember when we embroidered our dish towels and ironed them? Remember that?
Can you believe that?
I can't believe we ironed dish towels. But we did all these things that are in tatting. We learned to do the things that are becoming lost arts. Tatting for me is a lost art because I didn't learn it well enough as a child to remember. So now, if you're a tatting teacher out there, or if you're an embroidery teacher, or if you can teach cross stitch, or if you can churn butter, I mean, these things that our children are forgetting. There are 500 children right now.
Homogenized milk. That may be a challenge.
We'll have to find a cow, I guess. But we have 500 children who every day do not go home to grandmother. They are in a very safe and loving and wonderful environment.
So what you're saying is we may move it from some additional classes. That'd be a good idea to have them after school for the latch.
Would be latchkey children. And we could use them as volunteers, or we could put a course together.
$3 or $5. I mean, biggies, they can go, at least gasoline to go over.
So.
Carol Tall, you got me so excited. I want to go to all these classes. I don't know. We were going to tell some of these. Applique machine, baby hair bands, sweatshirt panning, of course, computers and the regular, early tax planning, fix-it-yourself plumbing.
Where a business has come in partnership with us, and this is, I shouldn't say the business name probably.
Well, sure you should. Basic camera techniques.
Uh-huh.
Go ahead and say the business name.
Okay, it's McDaniel Plumbing, and the way I found them, now this is true community ed. Our hot water heater died, and these wonderful plumbers came out on a Saturday and fixed my hot water heater, and 2 weeks later they came back and fixed everything else in my house.
All right.
And they were really great people.
We'll learn how to do that so we don't have to call them on Saturday.
And of course, I wrote them the big check.
Carol Tall, community education specialist, and I want you to hear something incredible about her, but I have to wait till the next time. I'm Bonnie Liphart. You're watching Vision Plus. Bless your heart for watching.
Thank you.
Hello and welcome. You're watching Vision Plus here on Victory Network. I am Bonnie Liphart, and you know what we're going to learn today, or perhaps explore? That's how to have a blessed day every day. I know we're coming up to holiday season. We're just going over the month of October, and I think October sometimes is one of my most favorite months because the children are back in school. We're not quite to the Thanksgiving and the Christmas holidays, and it's a time for reflection. We've just had that, and I think it stretches out for a few more days that we can have the fallout of blessings of just the quiet time before the holiday season comes on us. Don't you just love this time of the year? I know when we're coming in from Gunnersville and see the incredibly awesome beauty of that our Lord Jesus Christ gave us, of the colors, they're so vibrant this year. Haven't you noticed those? I'm just in ecstasy when I see them. And I just thought that just a couple of weeks ago, I had the opportunity to speak to a group in a women's prison, and we went through a little exercise that I call How to Have a Blessed Day Every Day. And no matter what circumstances we're in, we can have a blessed day every day because the blessings come between here and here. It's not what's happening outside of us, but it's how we respond and react to those blessings. And then we went on to Texas and then back over to Atlanta. They lost our luggage coming back from San Antonio because the plane left us in Dallas, and we had to change to a different airline. And then I had to go into Atlanta without my makeup. My husband was talking about it. He said, but they didn't keep me up without my makeup. They sent me back home again. Oh, wonder what he meant by that. But anyway, when we have a blessed day every day, it's because of three specific things that I think. And you know, the Bible talks to us so much about asking, seeking, and knocking. But I think there's more in-depth things that can happen in our asking, seeking, and knocking than just asking, seeking, and knocking. There's other things in the ASK, and I thought perhaps you'd like to know those. The A, I really feel like the Lord has given me for people in pain, and most of us have pain of some sort. It doesn't necessarily have to mean that we've had a death in the family or gone bankrupt or we've had some kind of major thing, although to me, any kind of divorce or disaster can be getting to work in your, for a woman, her hose can have a run in it, and sometimes they react as if it were a major disaster. But whether it's big or it's small, we can learn to deal with that. The A, I feel like, stands for the attitude of gratitude. Now, how do we get this attitude of gratitude? Well, my dad was a farmer and a part-time preacher and did whatever he could to keep us five children something to eat on the table. So one time when he was out of work and there was no crops that were doing well, and he had had a paint store that burned and he didn't have insurance, and he continued over the years to pay off his suppliers because he thought that's what he should do. But he took a ride over into Oklahoma and worked for one of his brothers over there. Then as he was coming home to Arkansas to see his family, well, it was during the Second World War, and the train was filled with soldiers. As we're seeing more and more during this period of time, we're seeing people in their uniforms, all different kinds of uniforms, and we see it on television all the time. Well, he was coming back on the train with all of the troops. The only thing, at that time, there was no air conditioning on the train. And they were just stuffed in there like sardines trying to get the troops across the United States, because a lot of times they sent them that way from one base to the other, one fort to the other. And so we lived in a little tiny town, Bay, Arkansas, that was, it took, you know, the hoot owls, we call those our watchdogs. It was so far back in the sticks that my dad had to wear hip boots to get us to the school bus. But when he was coming back, a couple of interesting things happened. One was that a little baby was crying on the train, and perhaps you've heard this story since it happened back in the Second World War. And a man was holding the baby and could not get the baby to quit crying. And one of the big old burly Texans everybody was kind of watching the baby and the father and getting irritated. And they were already irritated because it was hot and sweaty. And so this man went back over there to the man that was holding the baby and said, "Can't you keep that kid quiet?" Big old tears started running down his cheeks, and he said, the Texan said, "Why don't you give it to its mother?" And the father said, "Sir, I would love to give it to its mother, but she's in a casket in the train ahead of us, and we're going home to bury her." And that big old burly Texan dropped to his knees, and he said, "Oh, I'm so sorry. Could I please help you?" And he took that tiny little baby up in his big hands. His hands were bigger than the baby almost. And he put that baby on his shoulder, and he walked up and down that train aisle and got the little child finally settled down. And some of the people that were there, my dad said that he kept thinking about going to offer, but he didn't do it. He just, you know, sometimes you don't do the thought that's in your mind. A lovely thought is in our mind. We fail to set it free. From lack of exercise, it dies and makes it tomb in me sometimes when we have a good idea. So he was able to get that baby quiet, and that father had such an attitude of gratitude of the way that the whole train just seemed to come to his rescue. But wasn't it sad that first of all, they had to have this man to hurt the young father even more by the harsh words that he said? Wouldn't it be great if we could say the words we are thinking many times and the thoughts that go through our mind and go on and do that good deed that we thought about? I've thought so much lately about the Good Samaritan. Don't you wonder who our Good Samaritan, who the Good Samaritan is today, and how we're supposed to help? We say so many times, especially for women, we're told, don't stop and pick up hitchhikers. Don't do this. Don't help. You know, we're almost afraid to help people, and so we wonder how we're going to be a Good Samaritan. A couple of days ago, you may have read in the paper or saw that a girl's car caught on fire at the post office here in Huntsville. And I was thinking, had been thinking for a couple of days about this attitude of gratitude and how that we need to be the Good Samaritan, and how do we become that Good Samaritan and show this attitude of gratitude to our Father for the good things He's given us, all these blessings that He's given us. And every day I've been working on, and boy, I got a long ways to go. Don't believe me, I don't have it there yet. But how could today, God bring someone in my path today that I could pay back some of the blessings You've given me, of good eyes, good ears, a wonderful country to live in, all of the blessings that we have, marvelous television station here at Channel 48. We need to pour out our blessings to Channel 58 right now, just so that Victory Network can really be blessed. Well, anyway, as the car back at the post office was catching on fire and starting to blaze, it was before the post office opened, and the mother had left her little baby about a year old or so in the car, and she saw when she parked her car that it was starting to smoke. And so she ran back and got her little baby, and lots of times we do this. This just happens. It's not something unusual that people run into the post office and leave their child in the seat in the car. Anyway, she got the baby. Well, the car continued to blaze. She ran into the post office, and she said, "Please, could I use the telephone?" And the person that was doing the sweeping said, "You can't go inside and use our phone because we haven't opened yet. Go down there and use it." She said, "I didn't bring my purse. I don't have a quarter." And so he kind of appeared to be, you know, reluctant. And I'm only seeing the scurrying around. And I seem like sometimes I'm slow to catch on what's happening. Finally, I looked out and saw the car, and that the gasoline or whatever was causing it, the fire was just running across the ground and back to the back tire, which of course would be close to the tank. And finally, so many people were seeing that, because a lot of people come to their post office, the main post office, to pick up their mail. And so then we're just starting to bang on the doors. "Please let us in to call. Please call the fire department." Well, they did call, and by the time she got a quarter and back over to the payphone and called, well, they had gotten in touch with the fire department. It seemed like it took forever to get there. You know how a minute seems a long time when waiting for help. But
I thought I had to be to an appointment at 10 o'clock, and it's like 8:15 to 8:30. And so I went over and told her, I'd take you home. Of all those 30, 40 people milling around, no one else offered to take her home. And I probably wouldn't have either if I hadn't been so concerned lately about how can I be the Good Samaritan? What is a Good Samaritan? Who is my neighbor? How can I show other people my attitude of gratitude? And so I said, could I take you home, and where do you live? And so the fire truck came and was able to put the fire out. But it took them quite a long time. Her car was totally just, she didn't get anything out of it. After the foam settled down and she could wipe it off, she was able to get some pictures out that she had on the back seat. But I had the great privilege and blessing of taking her home. And we started talking about the thing to be thankful for. Her husband was out of town, and we were afraid he would panic. So when we got to her house, we stopped in front of the house, and we just prayed that he wouldn't panic, and thankful that she got her little boy out of the car, the little baby. And so many things we can be thankful for. If we look for, sure, it's terrible. It would look like a new car. It was a pretty car. And yet she had a truck that was her husband was at home, so she could still get around. And so there were things to be thankful for, and big tears ran down her eyes. But I just thought, what a blessing it was. And I went away from that experience so energized, thinking, I know how that Good Samaritan felt. When you have an attitude of gratitude for the blessings that have been poured on us, then we try to share them, drop that little pebble in the stream that permeates the whole area of all the places we touch. They're not blessed nearly as much as we are. She will never have been blessed as much as I was in doing that. Well, I just think that we have to work on having an attitude of gratitude. I can't end the story about my dad without saying one thing. He was a humorous guy. He thought funny. And as I said, we lived out in the middle of nowhere, little 500 plus cats and dogs, but we lived 3.5 miles out in the country from there. So everybody was complaining as they trucked along through the countryside, and they got to where my dad, where we lived, or 3.5 miles from where we lived, but the closest place where the train stopped. And so my dad said, well, I tell you what, it is just so hot in here, and this train is going so slow, I think I'll just get off and walk. So the train, he pulled on the little thing, and the train stopped and let him off. Of course, that's where his ticket took him to. And it looked to these people like he had gotten off in the middle of nowhere to, of course, he was going to walk 3.5 miles out to his home. But he said as far as he could see that train, they just had their eyes pressed against the windows looking at him, and they were just awestruck at it. He had a little fun, but it gave a little fun time after they realized that they finally had to figure it out, you know, they did, to bring a little laughter and fun into it. We have to do that, you know. There are so many things that the Bible talks to us about, the blessings that we have, and we think, well, you know yourself that he pours out his blessings on us, especially in Malachi it talks about when we tithe, he's going to pour out. In Luke it talks about the blessings that he pours out to us when we give to other people. Of course that means money, tithing is money, but tithing is time also. Tithing is what we already have. Tithing is the way, I even think of our attitude when we get up in the morning and things are not so terrific in our own life. But if we can put a smile on our face, you know, I'd rather see a fake smile than a genuine grouch any day. I think it would be perfectly all right to put a smile on your face because, hey, this is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And Luke 18:27 says, the things that are impossible with man are possible with God. There's always a way that we can be thankful and have those blessings, because even if we can't see anything in it or figure out a way it can be done, that we can have God's blessing, what's impossible to us is possible with God. And I know that even though the plane lost my luggage and I had to go to Atlanta without any makeup, and for a person with lots of freckles, that is not too fun. But I went on, and we just had a lot of fun. I think people had more fun seeing me with my face hanging out with all the freckles than anything that I could have done to entertain them. Let's see. There's another thing in Luke that I think when the S of ASK, of course, is to seek, but what is it also? I think it's to be sensitive to others. And that's what I have been learning lately, is how to be sensitive to others. And you know, I think that when God was talking, and it's Luke 18:41, Jesus was talking to the blind man. Now you know that Jesus knew everything. And you know that he knew when he was looking at this person that he was blind. But what did he say? He looked at him. Jesus looked at the blind man and he said, What would it be that I shall do for you? Let me read it right out of here, Luke 18:41. What wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? Now, you know he knew he was blind. You know he knew that's what he wanted. But yet he asked the question. I think when it says ask, seek, and knock, that we are to ask, we are to seek, we are to knock. We actually can be sensitive to others in our seeking and to maybe say, even though we look at someone and say, okay, do you need a ride home? Do you have enough money for groceries? Whatever it is we may think is very obvious, it could be that we could still ask them, what can I do with you? And you know that story about the lady in the same chapter when she went to the judge and kept asking him for something. And the judge said, he says, yet this widow troubleth me. I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Hear what the unjust judge saith. Now here he is, a guy that's unjust. He didn't even, it says, and shall not God avenge his own elect who cried day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? See, the unjust judge, he didn't necessarily believe in God. He couldn't care less about the woman. But because she kept asking, she kept seeking, she kept knocking, he said, okay, I'll do it. We're going to do what you want me to do. And I think that's the way it is with God. I know that there's, we got to have faith. Faith is a grain of mustard seed, and we ask people, we ask for something, and some people say, well, it's not faith if you keep asking. But also, God says, or Jesus is speaking right here in Luke 18:7, and it says, shall not God avenge his own elect who cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. I mean, hey, I'm going to do it. And I think that sometimes we just have to keep on keeping on and say, God, I'm not going to turn loose until you show me what you want me to do with my life. Having done all to stand, yes, we have to stand, and we have to have peace about it. My peace I give to you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. We have all of those. Malachi 3:10, where it talks about him pouring out a blessing. And then the 1 Corinthians 10:16, the cup of blessings which he blesses us with. And the cup of blessings to me, it's the cup that is never empty. The cup is never empty of the blessings that God pours out. Isn't that exciting? I love it, love it, love it. And then you know that out of our mouth, we decide actually whether blessings or cursings are going to come unto us. James 3:10 says that out of our mouth proceed blessings or cursing. Are we making a blessing or a cursing on our life? When we ask God, and he says, hey, don't turn loose until you get your answer. You keep on keeping on, being persistent. The one thing in all God, we were born for his good pleasure, yes. But also, he says, for us to enjoy our day and for us to have his blessings, the blessings of Abraham are poured out on us. We are the seed of, we are the spiritual seed of Abraham. I have a friend that just got back, two friends, in fact, from Israel. We're going to do a program about what they learned, and I have the Jerusalem Post, and it tells us some of the things that's happening over there in what I call the insane Sodom, Gomorrah, it's, you know, it's Sodom and Gomorrah. I think we have insane Sodom instead of Saddam Hussein. He's an insane Sodom and Gomorrah. And the things that are happening over there, and this person said that he felt that there would be a major battle within the next 2 weeks. I'm talking about major war. Well, we are to stay in peace with whatever the newspaper is saying, whatever we see on television, and we belong to Jesus Christ. And he tells us more than 365 days times in the Bible, fear not, fret not, 366 to be exact. And so remember, it comes between our head. Don't allow someone to tell you something that takes away your blessings, that takes away your feeling of depending upon God, that you are in the palm of his hand. And I was talking to a person that I've been taking a computer class over in Gunnersville. I was talking to this person, and I was telling them a little bit about Emily. Most of you know that she was my co-host here for a couple of years on Victory Network, and car hit her, and she went on to be with Jesus. And so I was telling her about Emily and told her that Lord had shown me to write a book. And by the way, if you would like to have one of the books, any donation to Victor Network, you will be sent a book. It really needs to be over $5, since it cost me $4 to have them printed. But whatever you send, we'll send you a book if you'd like to have one. It's just called Emily. I was talking to her, and she said she started crying. And this, even though I've been in class with her for a while, I thought, well, did she know Emily? Or have I couldn't understand why she was crying. Come to find out, her son had committed suicide in August of this year, and she said that he had, she said she didn't really believe he had done it because he was so close to the Lord, and she just couldn't believe he'd done it. But she doesn't have the money, and she is a widow. She doesn't have the money to find out what happened in the situation, and he was not near her at that time. He was in another place. But she can't believe that with the brilliance that he had that he did it. But she was in such great pain, and she didn't know the Lord Jesus Christ maybe like you and I do, or that you and I want to. When I spoke to the prison group a couple weeks ago, there was about 50 in the class, and it was a SATP stands for Substance Abuse Training Program. And every one of the 50 people gave their life to the Lord. Can you imagine that? I was just standing there watching what God was doing. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it that God is doing such incredible things. You know, he said he'd pour out his blessings on our sons and daughters. It's happening now. And another person I was talking to, that she, when I was talking to her husband, who had brought people to the Lord, brought their whole family who lived in Germany to the Lord. They lived over here in the United States. She's from Texas, but she has moved to the Tennessee Valley area. And she said that her husband, from all apparent reasons, had evidently, as far as they know, tried to commit suicide. He died from the effort. He was in the over in his garage. Now, he was able to walk through the house, and whether it happened by accident with the garage door down, couldn't get it up or whatever, they're not sure about that. But he did live some time. And she was in great pain. There are a lot of people in pain for different things. But, you know, if we will look at what's happening in the world, in our world, and remembering that it's between here and here, how we respond and react to our own pain, whether it's, as I said, the simple thing of you having a run in your hose when you get to work. I mean, some people get all bent out of shape, or you being late getting to work because they're working on the Memorial Parkway or whatever it is. But if we just remember to count our own blessings, can you see this television? You already have the blessings that man asked Jesus when Jesus said, "What would you that you would have that I shall do for you?" Shall. I wanted to make sure that it's not should, it's shall, because I looked it up again in Luke, and it really does say that. And in Revelation 5:12, he talks about us being worthy to receive his blessings. So if we just remember that it's ask, seek, and knock. Yes, ask for the things we need. Seek him and knock. But it's more than that. It's this attitude of gratitude, this being sensitive to other people's needs, and the K, knowing ourselves and knowing God. More than anything is knowing our God. Because when we know the Lord Jesus Christ and what he's done in pouring out the blessings to us individually and as a family and as a country and as a world, then by sending his only begotten Son to us, that he died, he appropriated my horrible sins on the cross so that I might have that opportunity, that he would, through his grace, make up the difference between this horrible, sinful person I am to what I should be, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so with that, knowing God, it will help us to know ourselves. I love you so much. If there's any way that I can help you, or anyone that you know of, a person in pain, please let me do that. And if you would like one of the books and a donation to Victory Network, you'll get it. Call 461-8148. I love you. Have a terrific, wonderful, blessed day. God love you too. Hello and welcome. You're watching Vision Plus. I'm Bonnie Libhart. Have you thought about what a vision is? Without a vision, the people perish. But have there been days you'd like to throw in the towel? I tell you what, there have been a lot of days lately. And you know, I even think they come in bunches like grapes. I knew my mom said there'd be a day like this every once in a while, but she didn't say it'd come in bunches like grapes. What I want to talk to you about today is how to keep that towel. Don't throw in the towel. Don't say it's the end, I can't take anymore. Let's figure out a way where you can. And I really feel like the God gave me three ways just for you. There's no reason that you shouldn't be watching right now and take this little time to whatever you're doing, just take a little breather. Sit down for a moment, get a wonderful glass of crystal clear water, something like that, and let's learn how to keep from throwing in the towel. Would you like that? Now, one of the things that I've been trying to do lately is really hear from God. And I even put aluminum foil on my antenna to hear from him, and I found out I must be wearing a wireless microphone, because it seems like that even though he says, "My sheep, hear my voice," I just wonder where he is. And there's been so many days lately I've felt like throwing in the towel. And even Brother Chuck said, "What's the towel doing that?" I said, "I am hanging on to that towel because I am not ready to throw in the towel yet, and I don't want you to be either. And the good Lord doesn't want you to be." Let's find out what those three reasons are. You know, we talk about prayer and being, some of you have been around us when we prayed, some of you we prayed with. I remember one day that I was praying for a girl and she got slain in the spirit in my big ring that has a history to it. It's a diamond ring. You've heard of those before, haven't you? But anyway, caught in her wig, pulled her wig off, but she still wasn't hurt. Sometimes we have things to happen, and from a little thing like losing your wig or having a run in your hose, or a big thing like I was talking to a person just this week that we were praying for him. They have a little 2.5-year-old boy, and he has an incurable disease, according to the world and to the doctors. But of course, we know we have a healing Father that's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that child can be healed. But when you have those things that happen, and the mother and dad are so distraught and hurt, and sometimes you just desperately need money to make it, there are needs. Victory Networks have great needs that money could help right now. There are many of us going into the Thanksgiving and Christmas season like we are without our Emily that went to be with the Lord in July. And there's many, many people that will not have some really precious loved one during this Thanksgiving and the Christmas season. How do we keep hold of our sanity? How do we keep from throwing in the towel? I think that there are three major things, and first of them that I feel God would say to you is, what would Jesus do in this situation? Now, back in history, even Abraham Lincoln, when he was shot, well, his wife, I understand from history, wasn't there in the 1860s, that she had seances. And then every year, every 20 years, for a few years after that, a president was killed. And some of you may remember, Garfield 20 years later, McKinley 20 years after that. And it just seemed like that every 20 years, a president would be killed. It was like a curse. But hallelujah, praise the glory. God tells us that in Galatians 3:13 that Christ redeemed us from the curse. So we can have curses, or we can say that our family has had curses from the last 3 or 4 generations. But in the name of Jesus, we can break those curses. Now, what would Jesus do? Well, first of all, what he would do, I think, is have us to receive redemption and forgiveness through God's grace. Now, how do we do that? How do we do that? Sometimes I hear people talking, and it's wonderful to hear they're talking, but how do we do that when we have a child in prison or a person on drugs or one of our friends' mother got arrested for DUI this week? It can happen to any of us because she was in great pain. People are in pain for all kinds of reasons. And it hurts the child. It hurts the people in the workplace. It hurts the person it happens to. But many times, I think it hurts the other people around them even more. Well, thanks for our inheritance, deliverance from Satan, Colossians 1:12 through 14, that God, what would Jesus do? He would remind us of these promises. He would say that I belong to the Father, and what I do is only what the Father does through me. So each time that we're involved in a situation or in a decision that we need to make, how to handle it through Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, 4th of July, Easter, February, the 14th of February, no one to love. Well, perhaps that we've had a loved one that's now gone. Just talked to a person, a friend of mine I knew 20 years ago. I said, "Well, how's Melinda?" He said, "Well, yeah, I guess you haven't heard in the last 12 years. I said, no, I really haven't been in touch with you, and I'm really sorry. I think that's one of my faults is over the years I don't always keep in touch with people I love very much. She has multiple sclerosis, and it just broke my heart to think that Satan is here to kill, steal, and destroy, but praise the Lord, John 10:10 says Jesus came to give us life and give it more abundantly. And so what would Jesus do in each one of these situations? If we remember in 1 John 3:8 that Christ destroyed the works of the devil, if it is not love, then it's from the devil. Now, I do believe that there are some times that from our flesh, maybe even God allows things to happen. I don't necessarily think that he kills children, brings diseases. I know that he doesn't. But when those things happen, it could grow us up. We can use that. When it says all things work together for good for those who love him, he can use those circumstances to grow us up. Luke 10 talks about the power from Jesus over the enemy. Isn't that great? That's what we have. Jesus, we are joint heirs with Jesus. You know what that word means? If you are adopted into a family, maybe it's the family that has as much money as the Rockefellers, and they adopt you, then you are joint heirs with the real brothers and sisters. So we are joint heirs with Jesus. We own everything that Jesus owns. We just have to appropriate it or write a check on it. I think that a lot of you remember the story of the woman that took the trip, and she had bought a ticket and was on Eurorail, which is they take these trips around Europe on train, and everybody else was going out, and they'd go, when they get to the hotels at night, they would go in and have a good meal, and she'd stay in her room and eat crackers and some things munchies she carried in her bag. And so toward the end of the trip, the tour guide said, "Hey, Helen, why don't you come in and eat?" She said, "Really, I just had enough money for the ticket. I didn't have enough money for the food." And he said, "Don't you realize that your ticket for the trip included the food?" And I think that sometimes we have to appropriate or call into the being those blessings that Jesus has for us. Now, secondly, after we've kept our eyes on Jesus and do what he does, then we take the steps of faith. Steps of faith. Now, in taking the steps of faith, I think there are several things that happen. And don't forget, if you can be stopped, you will be stopped. And if you cannot be stopped, you will not be stopped. Now, how do we keep that from happening? Faith. You hear it so many times, but calling into being those things which are not, as if they were. And that includes the effective prayer of forgiving, a forgiving attitude. Believe me, when a person hit and killed my daughter in July, I had a very difficult time forgiving that person driving the vehicle. I had a very difficult time forgiving the people that were with her. I'm not going to say I've done it totally and completely. I still have a little choking in my throat every once in a while that I need to be delivered so that I totally have forgiveness for those people. But I know that she is the winner in this whole thing because she's in heaven with Jesus. And then it means that when we have effective prayer in these steps of faith is to be in submission to the Lord Jesus Christ, which means in submission to the powers over us, which means submission to our boss, submission to our husband, submission to our church leaders, submission. And we do that in humility by having a real sweet, humble spirit. The one thing I've noticed after watching maybe several tapes, fortunately by us having a Victory Network, we were able to have 65 tapes, videotapes with Emily. And in those, I saw one of the things that you wrote to us saying that she had a gentle, gentle spirit. And that is one thing that I want to ask you to forgive me for, is the times that I have not had a gentle, gentle spirit. And that is one of the things that the Lord wants us to have, is this spirit of humility, this gentleness, the way Jesus was gentle. One day we went through the four different characteristics and aspects of a human being, and we talked about how that some people have this type A personality, and then there's the gentle person, the competent person, the dominant Don and Donna, the competent Carl and Carla, the influencing Ike and Ima, and the steady Stan and Stacy. When we look at those personalities, we might have one or the other, but Jesus had a perfect balance of all of those. Yes, he had humility, but he had the boldness, too, to throw the money changers out of his church because he would not have that building to be used. His house, he said, my Father's house to be used for a profit like they were using it. And then holiness. Holiness, how in the world can we have holiness? Only through Jesus Christ, him giving us that holiness. And then the earnestness and the importunity to do some of those things. Yes, step two is the steps of faith through effective prayer. And then third, in these steps of faith, we look in Luke 1:26, and it talks about the source of our faith being the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in 28, the blessings of faith. And 30, 29 and 30, there's hindrances to our faith. Yes, we want to believe, Lord, help my unbelief. Help my unbelief. I want to believe you. I don't want to hate the sinner. I want to hate the sin, not the sinner. And then in 33 of Luke 1, it talks about the word of faith. And then the inquiry of faith and the explanation of faith in 34 and 35. And then in 38, the decision to persevere. And 46, Luke 1:46 is confessions of faith. We need to confess our faith. And then when it says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, he that believeth not shall be condemned. Well, whose responsibility is that? Where's the world? Who are the Samaritans? The world is our world. Wherever God dropped us in the stream of life, this little pebble that has those little tiny ripples that go out and touch other people's lives, that's the people that we meet from day to day. I picked up a person this morning, and you know we're not supposed to pick up hitchhikers, but I just sometimes, this was a woman walking without her shoes on. She was carrying her boots. And I knew, even though I was on a busy street of Governors, that I just had to pick her up. And I just asked God to put the angels around to protect me when I do that. But she had to walk quite a ways to her house, and I took her over there. She had her husband left. She had no money. She had no car. She had no way to get any place but to walk. And so sometimes we have to just ask the Holy Spirit to show us ways that we can help other people. Now, the third way that we keep from throwing in the towel, we want to hang on to that towel, not throw in the towel, don't give up, don't commit suicide, don't let Satan put into our brain, into our thoughts, those he sits on our shoulders and says, you're not going to make it. Those people are lying to you. It doesn't work to go to church. You don't have any friends. You're no good anyway. He just says all these things right on our shoulder. You're $4,000 in debt. You're not going to make it. And he just always is saying that, sitting on our shoulders, whispering in our ear. But God says, don't forget, put a aluminum foil on your antenna so you can hear from God, and maybe you'll have something besides that wireless microphone. But we can keep from throwing in the towel, thirdly, when we experience God's grace. And I think that that is, to me, the key that I needed to hear, how to experience God's grace. And, of course, prayer. Is there anything in my life that is separating me from God? I have to ask myself that question. If I want to experience His grace, His unmerited favor, His saying, okay, I favor you. You know, when I was a little girl, and we would play on the schoolyard, and somebody would choose me first, or even third or fifth, just so I wasn't last when we were playing Wolf Over the River or some game. I loved it. I loved favor by my peers, by the other people in my class. We love the favor of God, and we can have God's unmerited favor. Unmerited, I don't deserve it, man. I didn't have the clothes the other kids had. I had dressed in flour sacks, dresses. But you know, even though from the time I was a little girl, when my dad's store burned, when we was I was 2 years old, and we didn't have any insurance, and I had to live on a cotton patch. Felt like I was in the cotton patch, but on that farm, no running water, electricity. You've heard the stories. I say we walked 3 miles to school in the snow barefoot, but my children say they think that's stretching it a little bit. My mother told me a million times not to exaggerate, but the fact is, unmerited favor is when God says, I choose you. Your name is written in heaven. One day I was sitting at the table when I was going to read the Bible through for Emily when she was at Christ for the Nation. I said, God, how am I going to say those big words? He said, and I said, why'd you even put them in the Bible? He said, because, Bonnie, I know you by name. He knows you by name. You're not just somebody watching Victory Network, Channel 58. You're not someone watching Vision Plus without a vision of people perish. He knows you by name. And he wants to give you that unmerited favor when you commit your life to him. So, okay, we have to commit every area of our life to God. I had to commit every area. The bankruptcy, divorce, the death in our family, prison, drugs. All of those things have to be committed to God. Everything I own, everything I am, he healed me from multiple sclerosis. I know he can heal you. He's healing our finances. He's healing my love for him because it wavers sometimes when he takes someone you love away. Even though you know that they're in heaven just praising the Lord, walking on the streets of gold in that big mansion he's made for up there preparing for us, then after that happens, we've committed every area, children, parents, finances, you name it, commit it to him, or whatever it is. Then resist the devil, and he will flee from you because he's made that promise to us. Resisting the devil, I resist you, devil. You quit lying to me. I lost my notes now. I don't know whether I'm going to say it. I will. I know it's what would Jesus do in the steps of faith and experiencing God's grace. Isn't that great? I can read even at long distance from way down there on the floor. Okay, and then after we resist the devil, you know what Jesus said? He said, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. When he was there and Satan was tempting him, said, I'll give you this whole world. He said, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. And when Peter was talking to him and said, well, that'll never happen to you, Jesus. You're not going to have to go on the cross and do all those horrible things that you're saying. He said, Satan would sift you, Peter. And so we have to take authority over the devil. Resist Satan. And then draw near to God. How do we draw near to God? Oh, that's so mysterious to me. And the only thing I know is just when I wake up in the morning, and I say, thank you, God, for the morning. Raining, sunshine, beautiful leaves, no leaves, snow, whatever it is. The heat works, the air conditioning works, the heat doesn't work, the air conditioning doesn't work. People calling you on the phone saying, give us all your dough. If I had all the money in the world, I'd pay them all my debts as far as they'd go. But whatever it is, we have to draw near to God by just talking to him. Don't you love it when you have someone that you love, spends time with you? I was talking to my son, and I said, Anthony, what do you want for Christmas? He said, oh, nothing. And, you know, big macho married man now. And I stood around a few minutes. I said, don't you know what you're supposed to say when somebody says, what do you want for Christmas? And he said, no, what? I said, you're supposed to say, no, Mom, what do you want for Christmas? I said, okay, so here are your words. Quote, this is the script. What do you want, Mom? He said, kind of laughing. He's used to me by now. He's had me for his mom all his life. But he said, okay, Mom, what do you want for Christmas? I said, I want 2 hours of your time. Not with your wife and children. Not with my husband and other friends and family. Just time for you and me to get reacquainted this year. Won't that be exciting? Don't you just love to be around someone that you love so much and they listen to you? They look at you? They sit on the edge of their chair and give you all that body language saying they're interested? Shoot. We sometimes have to ask the person to give us what we need. And I think that's what the Lord wants us to do. If we need something, ask. A-S-K. Ask, seek, and knock. And then Okay. And also experiencing the grace of God, this unmerited favor, we also cleanse, ask Him to cleanse my hands and purify my heart. God, don't let me be involved in anything that is not from You. Cleansing, sure, cleanse our hands, go wash your hands before you eat, children. Haven't you heard that all your life? But it's talking about not being involved in deceitfulness or anything, because it says that God will bless whatever we put our hands to do, but they got to be clean hands. And then purify our hearts. How do you purify your heart? You got to ask for it. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord. We have to ask Him for that pure heart. You know, it's not what other people do, say, or think, or how they act. It is how we respond to what they do. When back when I was 16 years old and I was married at the time, and the person didn't know Jesus, and he came to me and he told me he had a girl pregnant and he wanted to go marry her, and I said, we already have a baby. He said, doesn't matter, I want to go marry her. So he left. And my heart was crying inside of me. And I wanted so desperately to keep that person forever. And it didn't work that way. There's some things in life that don't work on our plan, our long-range, short-range, tangible, intangible plan. We prioritize our goals, our objectives, our reason for being in life. We write it down. We date it. We have all of these set in the world of things that our life is supposed to be. We grow up, we go to school, we go to college, we get married, we live happily ever after. You know why they always live happily ever after? That's because it stops at marriage. If you stop at marriage, hey, the marriage, yes, it was happily ever after, but you know what we noticed not long after we'd been married? In fact, later that same day, that trouble came into our life. So sometimes we have to purify our hearts by act of our will. Say, I will take authority over you, brain, your thoughts, your evil thoughts. No, I'm not tempted by buying pornographic material or going into a store. I can easily go in and tell them I'm not shopping here anymore until you get that stuff out of that store. I won't even purchase this that I have laid here on the counter until you take that stuff out. I want to write a letter to your boss. No, I'm not tempted by that anymore. But you know what I'm tempted with? Thoughts that come into my mind of BC, before Christ, of evil thoughts that Satan says, you haven't wiped that out of your brain. You still have those evil thoughts. Sure, but I don't. It's just like a bird that lands on your head. Sure, he can land there, but you don't have to let him make a nest in your hair. And even though those thoughts come across, they're just like the wind. It came to go. It passed through. It came through and it left. I humble myself before God and He lifts me up. I've had a terrible time in my lifetime, I think, because of inferiority complex of living on that farm and not having anything as a child, that I've always wanted to lift myself up. Hey, do you know what we did? And I have to remember that God vomits at people like me that do those kind of things. He wants us to stay humble before Him. And if there's any lifting up to do, He'll do it, or it won't be done. And then next in experiencing the grace of God is that we speak not evil of anyone. You know, sometimes I think I go to a full gossip church. You heard me. Some of these full gospel churches, I call them full gossip churches, because it seems like that they thrive on gossip. Did you know? And they want to pour out the things. Let me tell you what we need to pray about. And they just unload all the gossip of everything with the idea of that Holy Spirit of saying, now we need to pray for these people because, and then they tell you all the gory details. We don't have to listen to that. The minute it starts, we say, I really don't need to know the details. Yes, I will pray. You don't even need to tell me who the person is we're praying for or any last name. Just tell me that we need to pray and we'll believe God. Matthew 18:19, where two agrees as believing for anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them. And then to remember that we're not speaking evil of anyone and that we hate sin but not the sinner. So if we are going to keep the towel of our life and not throw in the towel, then we must remember to ask God
Jesus, what would you do in this circumstance? I can't hold on any longer unless you speak to my brain. And then to take those steps of faith, the steps of faith, because it says, calling into being those things which are not as if they were. Faith being the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And then experiencing God's grace, where it says in James 4:6, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. He wants to give us his grace. Grace, that unmerited favor that says, I choose you. I choose you. I know you from your mother's womb, from the foundation of the world, and I know you by name. If you would like for me to pray for you, call 461-8148. And if you would like the book about Emily, Born Again Marriage, Build a Better You Starting Now, the article that I've written that's in Guidepost of how to triumph over tragedy and about the putting your marriage back together, I will do that. We've started a group that's People in Pain, my husband and I, and we want to help you. If you're in pain for any reason, call us at 461-8148 or 539-3337, and we will pray for you. If we're not there, put it on our recordophone. We'll be glad to. I'm Bonnie Libhart. You're watching Vision Plus because God truly wants you to have a vision for your life, because without your vision, you would perish. Stay and hang on to that towel. Don't let it go. Don't throw in your towel. Let God help you. And if he wants to use me, praise the Lord. I'm Bonnie Libhart. Bless your heart for watching the Victory Network. Hello and welcome. You're watching Vision Plus. I'm Bonnie Libhart. Isn't this a very exciting time to be alive? Because we're in the end times and we get to watch it happening and unfolding. And just everywhere you turn, there's just so much wonderful things happening. And of course, there's things happening we don't understand. And we have a person with us today. We found out what she is. She's a crusader. You've seen her before, and you're going to get to see her now. She was a person that was in the Israeli army, mother of five. We're going to find out a little bit, a volunteer in the Israeli army. And you know, there's words in the Bible, the message that says, if we bless, that God will bless those who bless Israel and curse those who don't. We had a wonderful time in Israel a few years ago, but Loy Burgess, our guest today, has been there a couple of times. One of our other friends who's been to Israel four times this year brought me a Jerusalem Post magazine, and I'm going to just a newspaper, and the chief executive officer of the State of Israel Bonds, Mir Rosin, He was a former ambassador to the United States from Israel. Had a couple things to say, and I think it's tongue-in-cheek. He says, of course, Israel is to blame for everything. Today, for breaking up the coalition against Iraq. Tomorrow, it'll be discovered that the invasion of Kuwait was actually a Zionist plot. So there's, he says, if only the Jews would go back to being the victims. Well, there are people in this world that even, that feel some of those things, and they aren't saying it tongue-in-cheek. And one of them is a person who's come out twice in her life to not only say, I'm behind the Jewish people, but she's put her, as the expression goes, not only her money where her mouth is, but her body there too. Lloyd Burgess, welcome to Vision Plus.
Thank you, Bonnie.
Now, you get a vision to go and do something. Sometimes it's almost instantly. Now, I know you've been before as to the Israeli army,
right.
And your five daughters are already, as you say, out of the nest, so you're free to do some of these things, and it's not inexpensive to be a volunteer in the Israeli army. That comes out of your own pocket. So not only did you sand tanks and do some of those things, what did you do this time?
Well, this time they took us and put us in the Israeli Navy.
And you were in the Navy this time.
Right, mm-hmm. And that was a lot better. It was a step up. But I did inventory work, just posting inventory. And had I been an espionage agent, I could have really messed up their inventory because it was the end of the year. And they gave me total.
How did you decide to do that again? I thought when you came back last year and you had some challenges at the checkpoint area that you weren't going back again.
Well, they did give me a pretty rough time in Heathrow Airport in London coming back, and I vowed as I went down the gangplank to the plane that I would never go again. But about 2 months before I left this time, I began to just have a burning in my heart after reading a little bit about Israel in a newsletter. And the next morning wrote and asked for another application, and before I knew it, I was over there, and I had no intention of going, actually. But I had mentioned it to a friend of mine, and she decided to go too, and she brought a friend of hers. So the three of us met in New York, and off we went.
And this person, actually, you had mentioned it to her, and she didn't want to go.
That's right. She told me later that when I mentioned that I was thinking to go, she said, I'm sure glad it's her. It's you and not me. And by the time I got down to San Antonio where she lives, God had worked it in her heart that she wanted to go also.
Well, you came through Huntsville on your way and left some clothes there, and I sent them to Jerusalem. Okay. General delivery, Lloyd Burgess. I didn't know if you'd get them or not.
I got them. I sure was glad because all my clothes were dirty at that point.
And you were there when all of the activity was going on at the Wailing Wall and some of those.
The Temple Mount.
Yes.
Shooting. We were just on the next mountain over. Not Mount of Olives, where we were stoned earlier, about 2 weeks earlier, but we were over on the next mountain, Mount Scopus.
Well, now that you mentioned stone, tell me about that incident. How did that happen?
Well, that was the first weekend we were in Israel, and we, because of the timing that we went to Israel, they have three of their feasts. They have Rosh Hashanah, which is the Feast of Trumpets, Yom Kippur, which is the end of the year, the New Year celebration, and then they have Sukkoth, which is the Feast of Tabernacles. And we happened to be in Jerusalem for the Rosh Hashanah, and we went up to the Mount of Olives to spend the night at a prayer house that's up there, an American prayer house. But the Mount of Olives is strictly Arab, and while we were there, our rented car was not only stoned, but they beat the back window out the night before in a private locked garage. They saw us go in there, and they came in the night and broke out the window. But it turned out it was not because of who we were. It was because we had rented a car, and apparently the Israeli secret police used the rented cars. And so, as far as I understood it, the PLO have an edict that all rented cars are to be not only stoned but destroyed, burned. And so I was told by an Arab friend that we didn't get that car out of the garage that night, they'd burn the house down in burning the car up. So we took it up to the Intercontinental Hotel and left it for the night. And I gave him the key to it so he could come and bring it back to us the next morning so I wouldn't have to be dealing with it. Well, he arrived, and we got our luggage in it, the four of us. And as we drove through the Mount of Olives to get down off of the mountain, we were stoned so badly that we had to turn our car in. When we came off the little mountain we were on, we heard a whistle, you know, like boys do. And I can't do it, but we heard that, and just immediately the stone started coming down. And one of the dents was this big and that deep. And if it had come through the window, we would have really been hurt. But the Lord was with us. He protected us as we had prayed that morning for Him to do.
You were there. You actually blew the trumpet, shofar.
We did.
And
now that was the next weekend was Yom Kippur.
Mm-hmm. And their New Year.
Right, their New Year. And we went to Tel Aviv for that weekend. And we stayed on the beach during the day where it is total silence. I won't quite say total silence, but there's no automobiles, there's no motors. People, even on the beach, the children, there weren't very many of them because most people stay home and pray. But everybody talks very quietly, and it was a really beautiful time for the entire day to be almost silent. Then the following weekend was Rosh Hashanah. And Rosh Hashanah is the Feast of Trumpets is what it's called, and that's when the trumpet is blown. And we were not aware of this, but the trumpet is supposed to be blown in the synagogue. And one of the tours that we joined for the weekend, John Stembridge, he felt that the Lord had been prompting him that he should go and blow the shofar all the way through Israel, wherever the Lord directed him. So we joined his group and walked around the wall from the Damascus Gate of the Old City around on top of the wall, around to Dung Gate where the Wailing Wall is, the Western Wall. And we blew the shofar. We sang, and he blew the shofar at several different points, particularly at the corners of the Old City and over Mount Zion. And it just brought to my mind what Joel in the second chapter, verse 1 says, to blow the trumpet in Zion. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm.
We should have planned more of your singing, because Loy and I got started together 15 years ago or so, and I would go and speak, and she would come and sing, and so
you got me started.
That, another time. I wish we could just continue right now.
Well, one more thing I want to say about Rosh Hashanah and walking on the wall. There's scriptures that talk about the fact that God has His watchmen in the body of Christ. And I feel like for many years that that's who I am, what my ministry is the watchman on the wall, which not only means the wall of Israel, but the walls of life. And watchmen generally can see a long distance away and can see things coming.
They're more like a prophet, too.
Yeah, mm-hmm. True. They're like prophets. And they're also prophets. Intercessors.
And you're an intercessor not only for Israel and the Jewish people here in the United States, mm-hmm. and travel a lot of different places for that. Do you have another scripture you were about to allude to?
Yes, if I could take a moment out. In Isaiah 62, it says in verse 6, well, I'll start with verse 1, "For Zion's sake will I not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory. And thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name." And then I'm going to drop down to verse 6. "I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silence, and give him no rest till he establish and make Jerusalem a praise in the earth." And that's what the goal of a watchman is to cause God and bring into remembrance to God that he is to make Jerusalem a praise in the earth.
You know, it's going to be interesting when some of the things happen, like Andy Sorrell digging for oil, and I think they had spent like $6 million in that effort, mm-hmm. and it's continuing.
It is.
By
I think right now Andy is not drilling, but
another
man that I met over there, Hayseed Stevens from Weatherford, Texas, he has drilled and got down about like Andy did, several thousand feet, and then the drill broke off. But at this point in time, he is making efforts, and he, as we were with him in Jerusalem, he went to see Sharon and talked about drilling again. And now Israel realizes that what he's been saying is true. They've sent their geologists out, and they have found oil at the south end of the Dead Sea.
And they expect it to be the largest
oil field. Well, they
ever.
Said 18 billion gallons. That's what the Israeli government said, 18 billion gallons are down there. And ironically, I think it is right at Sodom, where Sodom and Gomorrah was, which I think we're living in a time when God is taking desolation and making a blossomed garden. He's taking the things that Satan has brought down and raising them up.
Even in the way they irrigate their land, the land that's just like, it was like a desert before. It's so beautiful once it's irrigated, and it just seems like it blossoms in addition to the land that's being used for digging for the oil.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. True. And they expect to find water down in this area. And this area that I'm speaking of on the south of the Dead Sea is quite desolate.
Oil.
It's like Texas, where I'm from. Mm-hmm. It's just sand and sand and more sand.
Mm-hmm.
But the scriptures say that God is going to take that area and make a watered garden of it, that it shall be even as the Garden of Eden. And as Sodom was in the beginning, apparently it was a magnificently beautiful place.
Are you surprised, or how do you feel about Amman, Jordan? I think that the Jordanians, leaders that have been supporting in the past, they've been wanting to get along with Israel and
mm-hmm.
have, and now they're actually, of course, joining hands with, I call insane Sodom of Gomorrah.
You mean Sodom
Hussein, but I call him insane Sodom.
Right, well, that's a good nickname, I think.
And so go ahead.
Well, I think you're right. I think King Hussein of Jordan has proven by his alliance with Saddam Hussein that where his true feelings are, and that he is not a friend of Israel nor the Western alliance.
Like we felt that he has
yes.
been for so many mm-hmm. years now. Well, you met a rabbi there, and a Hasidic rabbi.
A Hasidic rabbi, true, and he also is a Messianic rabbi, and we were fortunate enough to be able to be with he and his small group for
now,
about 3 days.
That means that's a Jewish person who actually believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, has committed his life to the Lord Jesus Christ.
A Messianic.
Messianic.
Jew, although he preferred that we not call him Messianic, he says that he merely believes what the Old Testament says, and of course we know in many places the Old Testament speaks of Yeshua HaMashiach being the Messiah, Jesus Christ being the Messiah, and he has accepted the entire Old Testament. A normal, run-of-the-mill Hasidic Jew is a very conservative Jew, one with the curls, and this man was quite different in that he believed in Yeshua. And we received a tremendous amount of revelation and teaching concerning the Old and the New Testament through sitting under his teaching.
Before we got too far away from that, I wanted to ask the feelings that the Israeli Navy, the people, know. Did they know you were Christians? Surely they would know that.
Yes, I think they knew it.
Elon?
Oh, well, the commander, the second in command of the entire naval base at Haifa, for some reason took a liking to us. We didn't understand quite why until he had his driver come by one day and take us to Tel Aviv from Haifa, which is about an hour's drive. And we were going to spend Yom Kippur there, and he's from Tel Aviv. Well, the next night, he and his wife came over to the hotel and had drinks with us, which we had asked them to do. And as soon as she walked in, she began to talk, and we found out a lot about Elon through her, and that is that he was raised a very orthodox, very conservative Jew.
And she called him a very religious.
She said he was a very religious. And so then we realized that more than likely he too, now I won't say that he is a Messianic Jew, but our hearts witnessed with his heart, and he was very kind to us, and we had much favor the whole time we were there from Elon, who is the second in command of the Haifa Naval Base, and he couldn't have been sweeter.
And before we get away from that, other people can volunteer to go there if they feel strongly
I'm a born-again Christian. And I just, several of my friends had gone and done this, and so I called Volunteers for Israel in New York City and just called them up and asked them for an application. And the only thing required, oh, there's several little minor things, but you need a rabbi's written letter giving his approval.
And how would we find one if you're in an area where there are so few?
Well, you can find a rabbi. You don't have to know one. I happened to know one for many years, and he sent me a letter from Baltimore. But I've talked to several other people who just found one and went in and talked to him, and they
agreed to it. It was okay to
as long as you time. As you realize that you will be expelled from the country if you try to proselyte in any way. And that is not my goal for going over there. I just believe that the Jews are God's chosen people. And I want very much to help them be established, because I think it's God's will for Israel to be established.
And truly, the country or the people or the person that blesses Israel, supports Israel, is going to be blessed. And anyone that would curse Israel will be cursed. So that's something we want to encourage always, our own people, our own families, our community, our state, our country, to continue to support Israel.
Yes, it is very important.
And pray for Israel.
And because of so many things like abortion and homosexuality and just general sodomy, homosexuality is not the only sodomy that's taking place in America today. And it is so widespread, sodomy is, that I'm amazed that God has held his judgment off of America this long. And I really truly believe the only reason he's held his judgment off is because we have blessed Israel. And I think when the day comes that we withdraw our support from Israel, and of course that day will come because the Word says that it will come, I think that's when we will face a tremendous, as you say, challenge.
Well, the person the rabbi that you met.
He said so many things it would be hard to even tell about him, but one of the most interesting was he mentioned that Basra, the town of Basra, it's an ancient town of Basra, was 14 miles east of where we were. And I had never really heard of Basra before, but when he quoted a particular scripture, which I would like to share with you, let me see if I can find it real quick. Isaiah 63:1. It says, "Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Basra? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine fat? I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in mine anger, and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in mine heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. And I looked, and there was none to help, and I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore mine own arm brought salvation unto me, and my fury it upheld me. And I will tread down the people in mine anger, and make them drunk in my fury, and I will bring down their strength to the earth." And what this rabbi shared with us is that according to the Word, and I have searched it out myself and found it to be true, that Jesus, like we've always heard, that he will touch down at the Mount of Olives and then go through the Eastern Gate. But according to the Word, and these Jewish rabbis, they know the Word so much better than a Christian does. Actually, Jesus will touch down at Basra and bring forth his destruction and fury on the Edomites. And I am wondering if, and then he will go to Jerusalem. And I am wondering if we are not at that time in the preparation of, we know that the Lord's coming soon, but we've never heard this before about his coming to Bozrah with his fury and his destruction. And I'm wondering if we're not in the midst with this Persian Gulf situation of the very setting up of this coming to pass.
Very possible. And we may be the ones in the that have already died that belong to him. We'll meet him in the air first, and we'll be right behind. So whether we're living or not living, we'll be there to meet him in the air and come back with him.
True. And the longer I'm a Christian, this is a little controversial, but the more I am coming to the belief that we're not going to be jerked out of this thing and not go through any of God's fury. I mean, I wonder, why do we as American Christians think that we won't suffer when the Christians all over the world have suffered? You know, why are we any better than the rest of the world's Christians? But I do believe that Feast of Tabernacles is one of the main feasts that I went over there to participate in. And that is when God is the one feast that has not been fulfilled of the Jewish feast. And that is when God is going to come back and tabernacle with his people. And I believe that whether he comes where we can see him and we're jerked out of this, which that'd be wonderful and I'm all for it. But if he doesn't, I believe his spirit will come in such a strong way that the word of God that says, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, that the fire of the Holy Ghost that will be so much stronger in us, we will be able to go through whatever comes. And we don't have to be afraid of what's coming. Not at all. And being from Texas, I know so much how we use, when we have a prairie fire, we can use another fire to stop the prairie fire. And that's how I see it, that we will have such a great burning for the Lord Jesus Christ, the Yeshua HaMashiach in us, that it doesn't matter what comes. I believe that if an atomic bomb, I'd like to share this. When I first became a Christian about 23 years ago, I heard a story about a young woman who was in Hiroshima. She was about 16, working in a factory, and when the bomb was dropped, the atomic bomb, and she woke up 50 miles away in a field. And she was a Christian, and somehow God protected her and saved her out of that situation. So that story has given me much faith through the years to realize that we have nothing to fear, absolutely nothing.
Because he's made the promises that whatever comes or whatever happens, that we will be in the palm of his hands and all things work together for good for us.
Right.
Yet another verse there.
I don't mean to leave on a somber note, so I'd like to read about, you know, before...
Well, I'm going to tell one little story about you, so okay. Go ahead.
We'll okay. This talks about, we are so close to the millennium, in my estimation. The 7 years of tribulation are going to go quite rapidly, and I believe that we're right, if not in it, we're right on the verge of being in it. But in Isaiah 35, I'd like to read these scriptures. The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. And an highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools, shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs of everlasting joy upon their heads.
Yay!
They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away.
Isn't that exciting?
Would you sing that with me? Yeah. Therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy shall be upon their heads.
That's beautiful. Loy, I want to thank you so much for coming. And, you know, I just really feel like you just quitted someone's appetite that would like to hear more. And
well, I hope so.
Yes. And if you do, Loy Burgess, our guest today, a mother of five daughters. Her husband ran for Congress and left, and I guess that was all part of God's plans and made it available for you to do the Lord's work full time now.
Yes.
And I was going to tell that one little story about the time that you were going to the plane. Your mom was taking you, and you just then told her where you were going.
Well, I left so fast this time that I didn't have time to really prepare my mother. I had 24 hours to get packed, and so she took me to the bus to go to New York. And on the way to the bus, she's 85, and I told her that I wasn't just going to New York, that I'd be going to Israel also, and to be in the Navy or the Army again.
Oh, my goodness. Do I have that to look forward to when I'm 85 and my children are still giving me these little surprises? Well, Mom, I'm going to the Mars or, you know, wherever we're going at that age. Well, Loy Burgess, it's been real inspiration and a hope and a promise of the Lord having us in His future. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Bonnie.
And thank you for joining us here on Vision Plus on Victory Network. I'm Bonnie Libhart along with Loy Burgess. Bless your heart for watching.
Amen. His presence with thanksgiving in your